A COVID subvariant that's on the rise around the world appears to be more infectious. But health experts say there's no indication the strain called EG.5 causes more serious illness than previous strains. Today, the World Health Organization updated its recommendations for handling the virus. The agency says it's especially concerned about a lack of data and reporting.
3 months ago, I declared an end to COVID-19 as a global health emergency, although I said that it remains a global health threat. Since then, the number of reported cases, hospitalizations, and deaths globally has continued to decline. However, the number of countries reporting data to WHO has also declined significantly. WHO continues to assess the risk of COVID-19 to global public as high. The virus continues to circulate in all countries, continues to kill, and it continues to change. WHO is currently tracking several variants, including EG.5, for which we are publishing a risk evaluation today.
Now, the WHO also says most of the world's population now has some immunity due to vaccines and previous infections. So we want to stay on the story for you. And for that, we've reached Dr. Prabhat Jha in Toronto. He's an epidemiologist and professor of global health at the University of Toronto and St. Michael's Hospital. Dr. Jha, thank you for making time for us today.
Good morning.
Okay, so what separates the EG.5 subvariant from the other strains that we've had experience with in the past few years?
Well, think of it as a cousin of Omicron that's a little bit slippier in terms of more likely to cause infections. And so it's a variant within the variants of Omicron, the same variant that really caused lots of infection now well over a year ago. So what the concern is whether the number of cases will grow. In the US, this EG5 variant now is the dominant strain circulating. And the concern is that going to cause pressure on particularly infections in the elderly, in those that have weakened immune systems, and therefore lead to an increase in hospitalizations? It doesn't appear that it is going to necessarily be that way, but we have to be diligent and make sure that we're continuing to monitor this virus. We also have to be very careful to make sure that all of the elder Canadians and those with weakened immune systems, such as my mother, are those that get the booster doses of the vaccine reasonably early in the fall.
Will the booster doses or the vaccines be able to combat this new variant as it, you know, the vaccine wasn't created when this variant emerged?
What we found is that basically any type of contemporary vaccine, not necessarily the Omicron variant of the vaccine, but even the ones that was used before, provide pretty very good protection against hospitalizations or death. Against infection, it's a bit more variable, but at least the preliminary biologic evidence suggests that the vaccines that we are using for combating Omicron should also work against this EG5. But the key is that although we have, as mentioned in the WHO release in Canada, wide or high levels of population immunity, and that's from a combination of about 90% of Canadians getting vaccinated at least twice, and well over 80% of Canadians getting infected by COVID at least once. That combination creates hybrid immunity, which is good at the population level, but you have particular populations whose immunity can fall. So that again are the elderly, the immunocompromised, and those with weakened immune systems. And those people need to get a booster to be able to combat this next strain.
Now, we were talking earlier about the spread here, and you were talking about how, you know, in the U.S., the numbers are on the rise. At the moment, it is the most common strain of COVID circulating right now. In Ontario, for example, data shows the testing positivity has increased from 5% to nearly 7% within 1 month. As we look at this, as you say, new version, cousin of Omicron, very infectious, and we head towards school starting in a few weeks, I'm wondering how concerned Canadians should be about that. We know that before it was believed to perhaps be a bit of a catalyst with spread once that school season starts.
Yes, of course, schools reopening, us resuming closer contact in the fall, being indoors more when the temperature drops, all of these things will increase transmission. But we have very good tools to counter those, and the most important of which is to get a booster dose for those at risk, the elderly, immunocompromised in particular, or those with chronic diseases. And that's what the National Advisory Council on Immunization has recommended, is those groups be at the front of the queue to get the fall booster doses. But we also have other tools that it's important to remember. People should keep kits at home, test kits at home. And if they have any symptom, they think, well, I can't have COVID because I already had it. No, you can get it again. They should test. And for those that are eligible above a particular age, you can get Paxlovid now very easily. The pharmacies are dispensing those, and it's widely available with GPs to counter, at least in the elderly, the risk of getting seriously sick. And most importantly, or not to forget, I should say, we should be masking. I certainly have returning to masking in public places like on the Toronto Transit. And I think we should be returning to masking. I don't think we'll have a mask mandate, but people should sensibly mask if they're at risk or if they're if they have any elderly people that they contact, then like grandparents, then they should also be masking.
Finally, I wanted to ask you, we were listening to the WHO, who was saying that essentially the case reporting has gone down as it would because fewer people are testing, fewer people probably going to healthcare providers, so the data is simply not there. And a lot of people want to forget about COVID. Do you think that with this new variant and perhaps the emergence of other subvariants, that it's possible we could go back in time and see what we saw, you know, a year or two ago?
I don't think that's likely because of the same reason. We built up high levels of hybrid immunity, but that's not in everyone, and the immunity isn't high in everyone. So the groups that are most vulnerable, vulnerable meaning they're at risk, not of infection, of being seriously hospitalized, that's the elderly, immunocompromised, or the chronic diseases. That's where our focus should be. So I don't think we're looking at a scenario anything as bad as we had during the Omicron peak or even before in the Delta peak. But I think what WHO mentioned is very important. We might be tired of the virus, but the virus isn't tired of us and will continue to spread. So that means we have to live with the virus. We know how we can live with the virus. So schools can stay open. We can carry on with work and meeting friends, but we have to be diligent. So I think the same key things apply. Get the vaccine, keep test kits at home, and wear masks in all the appropriate places. With those things, I think we'll be okay in the fall. I'm not anticipating a major increase, and I think most experts aren't anticipating a major increase. But the concern is the elderly not being sickened and really overwhelming our hospitals. That's the worry, not a widespread kind of a pandemic scenario like we had in the past.